Jamie Vardy, From Nowhere, My Story, by Jamie Vardy. Read by Stephen Kynman. Prologue. Jamie Vardy's having a party. I reached into the thin blue carrier bag, pulled out the first can of Stella and cracked it open. It was 11 a.m. on Bank Holiday Monday. The streets around Leicester City Centre were quiet, and for the next 7 hours, a needle loaded with ink was going to be jabbing into my ribs, stomach, hips and back. A four-pack was my anaesthetic. There was a close sign in the window of Blue Ink Tattoo Studio on Belgrave Gate, but they'd agreed to open for a private appointment I'd been trying to organise for weeks. The owner had a day off after scoring the equaliser at Manchester United 24 hours earlier, but Wes Morgan's staff made me feel right at home as I sipped on the beer they'd picked up for me from the off-licence around the corner. A couple of passers-by did a double-take as they glanced through the window and saw me perched on a stool in the reception area, running my eyes over the pocket watch design that had been drawn up to mark the birth of my daughter, Sophia. I couldn't help thinking that it looked a touch more professional than my first tattoo, which was done in someone's living room in Sheffield and cost me £25. I took off my T-shirt and walked into one of the treatment rooms, set up my iPad on a little table and watched three live matches, Walsall v Fleetwood, Brighton v Derby and Burnley v QPR, back to back, grimacing and wincing as my skin sweated blood. There was one more game to tune into later in the day, but I needed to be out of the tattooist's chair and at home when that kicked off. It was Chelsea v Tottenham Hotspur at Stamford Bridge, and by the time Christian Fuchs and Robert Huth picked me up just after 6 p.m. to head back to Melton Mowbray, the internet was rife with reports that Jamie Vardy's having a party. So much for the plan we'd made at Old Trafford to keep things secret. Wes was on the phone to me in the afternoon, more interested in discussing the arrangements for later than receiving an update on my tattoo. The captain wanted to make sure that every player was comfortable with Leicester's media team coming along to film and photograph any title-winning celebrations should Tottenham fail to beat Chelsea. In the end, we agreed to let a few of them attend a party that may as well have been advertised on flyers because there were that many people camped outside my home and craning their necks to look over the boundary wall. Inside the house, half a dozen lads were scattered around the television screen in the kitchen, while the rest set up camp in the snug room as bottles of beer were passed around along with the odd glass of whiskey to calm the nerves. I was lying on the floor, eating nibbles and trying to get into a position where my tattoo would cause me the least discomfort. Everybody was chilled and relaxed until kickoff. Then we put our Chelsea shirts on and may as well have been sitting in a city centre pub as we screamed at the TV, "Send him off, ref!" after any Spurs foul. Every swear word under the sun came out as Harry Kane rounded Asmir Begovic to open the scoring. And when Spurs doubled their lead just before half-time, it killed the atmosphere dead. "Well, this was worth sorting out," I said to Wes. It had turned into no more than a bank holiday piss-up for the lads, and we could all imagine the headlines the next day about Tottenham spoiling our party, complete with photos of glum-faced players leaving my house. Chelsea looked dead and buried, and our minds were already turning to the home game against Everton on Saturday. "We'll just have to finish the job then," said a few of the lads, trying to raise spirits. Yet just before the hour mark, everything changed. Willian took a corner and Gary Cahill beat Hugo Lloris with a left foot shot that transformed the mood. "Fucking get in!" All of a sudden, it was game on. We weren't just Chelsea supporters anymore. We were playing for Gus Hiddink's team. Trying to touch home Eden Hazard's low cross at one end and block Christian Eriksen's shot at the other. Then it happened. Hazard picked up the ball wide on the left, wriggled past a couple of players, rolled a pass into Diego Costa, got it back and... fucking hell! With one fantastic swing of his right boot, the Chelsea number 10 curled the ball into the top corner and Melton Mowbray had liftoff. People were running everywhere. Riyad Mahrez and Matty James skipped through a stairgate to join a pile of bodies hugging one another. I took the shortcut and somersaulted from the kitchen to the sofa in the snug room, a move not seen since I scored on the opening day against Sunderland. And Marcin Wasilewski was dragging Wes around the kitchen by his ankles. It was pandemonium. With only 7 minutes remaining, everybody congregated in the kitchen, where the media team were frantically setting up their equipment. We were within touching distance of the TV, as well as the title, standing shoulder to shoulder with one another and not daring to take our eyes off the screen as we counted down the seconds. It was like getting ready for Big Ben to chime midnight on New Year's Eve, except that occurs every 12 months. Leicester winning the title hadn't happened in 132 years. 6 minutes of injury time were up and the clock was edging towards 97 minutes when Willian played the ball out to Hazard, who took a touch before the final whistle sounded. Referee Mark Clattenburg must have blown three times, but we only heard it once. The room just erupted. It was crazy. We were lost in the moment, going completely wild as we danced around the kitchen, screaming and shouting, embracing and clinging onto one another. A camera was flashing, people were bouncing off walls, the TV went on the blink, and we started singing, "Champione, champione, ole, ole, ole." I couldn't take it in, and nor could anyone else. One of the lads was in tears, while another just kept shaking his head. Outside, a couple of the players were having a quiet moment to themselves on the steps down to the garden, where the lawn looked more like a prison exercise yard as people paced up and down. A few were on the phone to wives and friends, others were just trying to make sense of it all. But nothing made sense. Not when the final whistle blew, and not when I went to bed 6.5 hours later. Leicester City, relegation favourites and 5,000-1 title outsiders, were the Premier League champions. Chapter 1, Blue and White Stripes. David Hurst. I didn't want to be anybody else. Once I had a ball at my feet, which was every spare moment of the day, I became the legend who played up front for the club I loved. I idolised David Hurst because he did exactly what I wanted to do, score goals for Sheffield Wednesday. Only he did it better than anyone I'd ever seen. Left foot, right foot, headers, tap-ins, volleys, thunderbolts, you name it, Hurst scored them. Just as I did when I recreated all those goals, complete with running commentary, in my back garden in Maylin Bridge, or in the pub car park across the road, where a climbing frame outside the Yew Tree Inn doubled up as a goal. David Hurst might not have known it, but he was every bit as prolific on that little area of concrete as he was at Hillsborough. My parents lived across the street from the pub, in a three-bedroom semi-detached house on Loxley Road that we moved into towards the end of my time at Maylin Bridge Primary School. I'd often kick about in the car park until it was dark, playing the game Wembley and trying to get a goal that counted double by shooting the ball through a couple of triangles that were conveniently positioned in the top corners of the climbing frame. Ashley Cross, who lived a couple of streets away and went to the same school as me, would usually be one of the dozen or so lads joining in, along with Tim Stanton and his brother Ben, who went on to be a guitarist in an indie band called Harrison's, named after Harrison Road, which was a stone's throw away from the pub. I'd nearly always have my blue and white striped Wednesday kit on, reliving the games I'd watched at Hillsborough, which was less than 2 miles away from our house, dominating the area as well as my childhood. My dad first started taking me to Hillsborough when I was around the age of 5, and we'd be on the Kop, which was one of the biggest single-tier stands in Europe. There was room for about 20,000 people. I didn't even know there were that many Wednesday fans, on a huge banked terrace that seemed to go on forever. As I was so little, I'd get lifted up onto one of the blue handrails, and nothing could beat that view. It was like looking out on a field of dreams as I watched John Sheridan, John Harkes and Nigel Pearson playing for a Wednesday team that finished third in the old First Division in 1992. I loved the atmosphere, the singing and the roar when Wednesday scored, but most of all, I loved the striker everybody called Hursty. The Wednesday number 9 had a left foot like a rocket. His 114 miles per hour volley that nearly broke the crossbar at Highbury in 1996 was recorded as the fastest shot in Premier League history. And whenever he got the ball, you could feel the excitement. I expected something to happen, and so did everyone around me. Sir Alex Ferguson kept trying to sign him for Manchester United, but Hursty spent more than a decade at Hillsborough. Wednesday felt like his club, just like it was my club. And when he pulled on that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.